That's it.
No further questions about that first day there. The second time you went back with Mr. Schaefer, he's a little more specific. Was there any discussion about things in the house? His answer, just general conversation. This fascinates me because maybe a witness testifying and they couldn't remember a date. It would take us 10 minutes to get an item marked for identification, the person would identify, that's the date. But knowing what's in his statement, the state is satisfied for you to hear that the first time he's there, I believe he was there, and the second time, it's just general conversation. Well, I cross-examined Mr. Burke about exactly what was in his statement. With excitement. He was finding great things in the house that he could turn around and sell. And here it is. And that he had an arrangement with the owner that he could keep anything he found. The leaves keeper's there. Back with his brother. Any conversation about things in the house? Just general conversation. Here we go. I came back the following week. A lot more had been taken out of the house and thrown into the dumpster, and even more things had been set aside by Keith that he intended to sell or trade in for money. No, let me have this marked for identification by the state. Mr. Burke, does this refresh your recollection? They didn't do that. It had to come out on cross-examination. Why? I guess they're hoping that we're going to miss this. That we're going to miss some of the things that are absolutely fatal to the state's case. Well, we did. I said, you heard it, but you had to hear it on cross-examination. Were you getting the whole truth? I suggest not. You know, when I, think about Mr. Burke, we're not done yet. I may date myself a little to this, but it's a movie from your parents called Naked Gun, just to be my gun. There's a point where Ricardo Montalbán, he's the villain in the movie, and Priscilla Presley, she's got a female role, and he's the villain, and she wants to know, become so devious? His answer was, I spent 3 years at the development. And that's what comes to mind when I think about the guy who knew that Lisa Linda wanted $35,000 for this house and he bought it for $34,000. Couldn't go that extra $1,000. And he sells it for $400,000. And he bought it as a tear down. That's the note that Lee Levitt has in his file when he gets the call to prepare the contract. But as Keith is moving stuff out of the house, I guess he realizes, you know what? I can make more money by just cleaning this place out and repair it. And I sort of like the whole way. I don't care about it making a profit today because we're going to be talking a little later on about what happens when you think of yourself in your story and it's bad and changes. Who else did we hear from? Well, we heard from Dr. Bowie. Dr. Bowie told us two important things. Number one, savings bonds, not gold savings. Number two, she corroborated what we understand what happened. Her mother didn't want her to be at Medford for the system. So they created this fiction that she was living in Medford. Okay? That's on mom. We understand what mom was doing. But when Lisa Linder comes in court and tells you that she lived in Neptune those years, she's lying to you. She's perpetrating that lie. You know, she simply said, look, that's what my mom did, and that's why she did it. But she's taking the oath to tell you the truth. Mr. Fagen sort of stole my thunder a little bit on this false and one false and all. It's in charge the jury judge is going to do. About if somebody lies to you as a jury, I'm not talking about a bias who admitted you lied or came and admitted you lied. I'm talking about somebody who asked you who's important to lies to you. Like I'm going to suggest Mr. Burke and Lisa Linda have. The judge is going to tell you that you can take the position and if you're false, speak anything false or not. The analogy I use is a little quicker than Mr. Fagan's. It's just that, you know, to get into a bowl of stew, that first piece of meat is sour. You know, you can keep prodding around here to find a good piece, or you can do what you should do and push it away. And that's what you have to do. And looking in the house to see if there's anything worth keeping or selling independent of the house. And there's this big old safe, got records, canceled checks, Mr. Burke described some of them as payroll receipts. So business records, and what appears to be an empty box. And she sells the house to Elaine Palmer and Samuel Palmer in 1965. Why is 65 important? It's interesting because from 1933 to 1964, it was illegal to possess those bonds, these certificates, I'm sorry, those certificates. If you had them, you were required by the law to turn them in to the dean. You couldn't hold on to them. Which is the explanation why they were secreted in this box. Maybe they can put under there before the safety requirements. Who knows? In any event, that's the explanation. Now the judge told you about how you can use circumstantial evidence. And that's what this is, circumstantial evidence. Is there any evidence to support this being the safe the gold certificates from Lisa Linder's grandmother? None. Zero. Circumstantial evidence points to this as having been put there by somebody in the Abrams family. And I suggest to you the logical conclusion is it was either lost, you adjusted to the word lost, when Lewis and later Stowe died. And then abandoned by Anne when she sold the property. And we looked at the safe, not seen anything that she was about the safe. Which is critical for the testimony that later discuss about every lax. We all agree it's an expert anymore on both real and personal property transactions. Judge,
so what we will do now is we're going to recess for lunch. All right? Don't discuss anything about this case during the lunch recess. Don't do any research. And if anyone should attempt to communicate with you about any aspect of this case, don't talk about it with your fellow judges. You let me or my staff know about that right away. At 1:30, follow the same protocol. We'll bring you back up and we will continue the closing arguments of Mr. Benedict, and then you will hear from Ms. Eifer, the state. All right? Enjoy your lunch. See you back here at 1:30.